Okay, Christina, let's talk about how useful the findings of the Quad Committee are to the ICC's investigation, considering that President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. remains firm that the Philippines will not rejoin the ICC.
Well, it's a separate matter altogether, the rejoining of the ICC or reaccession to the Rome Statute. What is material for us right now is that there is an ongoing investigation which has taken root already. It's looking into crimes against humanity in relation to the war on drugs. And for us, that is primary. How important or how significant the Quadcom committee findings so far have been is that they constitute relevant and material evidence that could be presented before the court. And for us, it's just a matter of how these documents or these revelations can be brought to the court, how this can be taken in as evidence, and how they can, these witnesses can testify before the court themselves.
Right. Christina, these are public hearings, meaning the ICC is very free to use them or to include them in their accounts or in their reports. But which key points would you want to focus on when it comes to the House Quad Committee, which has spanned for over months?
Well, one, this is the first time actually with Rowena Garma telling us that President Duterte is present. This is the is involved in all this scheme. This is the first time that someone has told us of the president's direct participation from her own personal knowledge. In the Quad Committee hearings, we've also come to know that, as it turns out, EJ case is part of one criminal enterprise that encompasses online gaming, even the drug trade, and so forth. This is not just one murderous scheme. So to put it in context, has been very significant and will be significant for the ICC investigation. Even though they will not look into the online gaming connections, etc., the mere fact that this criminal enterprise exists now points us to a group of people who might be most responsible, and that is key to this investigation. They're looking at who are most responsible and who to take to trial. So right now for the ICC, I think they're keeping a real close eye on the proceedings. Otherwise, they won't be doing their jobs.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of finding the person who is most responsible for the massive killings here in the Philippines, how does the ICC now view Rowena Garma? Should she be considered as a witness, or would you say that she should be instead included as a respondent in the ICC's case?
Well, one, I do not represent the ICC per se, and we would have to ask the Office of the Prosecutor how they would qualify Rowena Garma. But for me, as one of the lawyers for the victims, I would say that Rowena Garma could even be qualified as an insider witness. The thing with the question of who is most responsible, it's a question of degree. So relativity as to the responsibility of other respondents, it has to be weighed. But from our view, it has been clear from the very beginning who is most responsible. Rodrigo Duterte, if he was the one in question, if he was the one surrendering or volunteering himself as quote-unquote, in the Philippines, we call it a state witness, then of course, definitely not. But as to Rowena Garma, we would have to factor in the participation of all the other actors in this, well, I hate to say it, but this telenovela. But in this criminal enterprise, encompassing again, Pogo, drug trade, and then extrajudicial killings, and guns, mercenaries for hire even, I would say that common to all of them, tying all of them, would be Duterte, Rodrigo Duterte, no less.
Right. As a veteran legal practitioner, Christina, how do you actually preserve the credibility of a witness at this point, considering you have someone like Kerwin Espinosa flip-flopping? How do you ensure that Garma eventually would not turn against what she said currently, especially when there is already a change in administration here in the country?
Well, unfortunately, in any legal jurisdiction, there is no guarantee against that. But especially if the witness, if the person is not telling the truth in the first place. But for us, and particularly in the ICC, there are certain rules, procedural rules, that you have to follow before you can take in testimony. And these rules, well, hopefully try to ensure the certainty of the person making the statement. And because of cross-examination opportunities, to test the credibility of the witness. And so we're looking at either a deposition or a physical testimony during trial for any of these witnesses to establish either their credibility and the probative value of what they're saying.
Mm-hmm. Christina, was the reward system a fresh revelation for you and your counterparts in the ICC, or has this already been established during earlier fact-finding missions of the panel?
There were witnesses who came forward to talk about the reward system during the DDS era, so-called DDS killings, at the time that Duterte was mayor of Davao City. But Regina Garma is the first one that has linked the president directly to it. Prior, there were only information, there were reports, and none have come on record. I think Regina Garma would be the first one who has publicly come on record. Of course, there might be other pieces of evidence that the ICC is in possession of now, but in the end, we'll only see that unfold during trial.
And in terms of questioning, what loopholes do you see present here? What questions do you hope lawmakers to further ask their resource persons and witnesses in the QuadCom hearings?
Well, aside from who else are involved in these schemes, and then for these people who would be involved, to cross-examine them as well as to their participation. We also note that Rini Garma's testimony does not talk about her own and personal responsibility. She always disclaims it, saying that I just introduced them and then they continue talking separately, independent of me. Perhaps they could also talk more about how these killings were conceptualized, how these orders were brought down or sent on to the people who executed them on the ground. And then lastly, of course, it would be important to know the why. So far, we've known that, yes, they are put on drug lists, etc., but why? How are these people identified? In some of the cases, it turns out that they aren't even targets or persons on the drug list, but that they're just political. This is just political vendetta. So why? Who, how, and why?
Okay, quite basic questions, even for journalists, the 5 W's and H, still not established despite the length of these hearings. What about the operations inside jail facilities? What key points have you gotten so far with regard to the credibility of Philippine penal colonies here?
Well, you have no less than a top official of the Bureau of Corrections talking about this. For the general public, we would have an inkling of what's happening from media. But media, especially movies and television shows, tend to come from personal experience. And with that, I could say that it's not unimaginable that these things have happened. What we just need is for these people to come on record. Several of them already have, and perhaps that could establish a pattern of what's happening in these facilities. Again, just to backtrack, as to everything that's been said, we need people to come on the record for all of this. And we need to differentiate from the things that we have established by chismes or by reasonable or suspicions. But we need to establish what has been said on record.
Okay, you've been putting an emphasis on people coming on record. Is still this a challenge for you under this administration, or do you find more people more willing to come forward?
Still a challenge. Security risks to the victims exist because the same perpetrators, on the ground, they would know that it's the police who have committed these killings. The same perpetrators are in the same police stations. The same perpetrators are in power. I mean, it was until recently that Edilberto Leonardo was in the NAPOLCOM, which is the agency which is supposed to be the oversight of police operations. That's the board, the body where you complain of police abuses. And with him on it, I mean, definitely it would be very difficult to secure a guilty decision. And so the same people who have executed the war on drugs are still there. And you have two senators, Bongo and Bato de la Rosa, who are even saying that they would open a Senate investigation. How ludicrous, how farcical would it be that the killers or those who are behind it will be the ones investigating themselves? For the victims, we think that even with the Marcos administration disclaiming any connection to the, well, to the Duterte administration, same people, same policies, in fact. In one of the hearings, it was admitted that the Oplan Double Barrel, Operation Double Barrel, Finale, is still in place. It's the fourth stage of Double Barrel.
How then do you prod people to come on record despite all these conditions you've laid out before us?
Well, with safety guidelines. Thankfully, before the ICC, there are some sort of measures. And in fact, we've been looking at a website. This is OTP Link, where you can submit through the internet information about the war on drugs. It could be a particular incident. It could be about the pattern. OTP Link is sort of a secure platform that where you can send in, even anonymously, information about the war on drugs. There are other ways to reach the ICC, and we're looking at opportunities for the victims to come forward, even without naming them or disclosing their locations, disclosing their contact numbers. And you can do that through organizations. But also, there comes the factor of, so as soon as we have come forward with information, are we protected? Under the Marcos administration, I can't really say yes.
Mm-hmm. And how soon can we actually expect the ICC to come out with a more updated decision, or at least resolution, that already somehow covers what has been discussed in public sphere?
Well, the ICC works really slow, to be frank, because it's very meticulous with its evidence gathering, evidence tagging. Every piece of information, every piece of paper is numbered, analyzed, vetted. And I would say that right now, they are already cognizant of what's happening before the Quadcom. It would just be a matter of time before they get the official records and authenticated records. By the end of the year, I'm looking at further developments, because the end of the year is a time when they reconfigure things out and see where their investigations should take them in the next year. But independent of that, one key development would be the issuance, possibly, of a warrant against the most responsible persons. We've heard about the summons already issued against five top officials. We're very much looking forward to issuance of a warrant of arrest and eventual enforcement, so that trial can ensue. The thing with trial is that when it begins, that's the time when officially victims or witnesses can come in as participants in the trial. And that's a time, that's a signal for possible protection mechanisms to kick in.
And just to clarify, these particular warrants that you are expecting, are they part of the so-called further developments that you hope to happen by year end?
Well, they are related to earlier announcements and earlier developments. But again, the ICC works really meticulously. So I'm hoping before the end of the year, there could be issuances, not only because of Ruina Garma's statements, but because of strong evidence already held by the ICC.
Right. But would you say at least that the ICC can somehow wrap up its investigations before the dawn of 2028, when possibly another Duterte will rise into power?
Well, with that long a period, yes, I would hope that we start trial before 2028. And that's crucial in a sense because that could also be a time that Sara Duterte, one of those who comes under the scope of the investigation, could become president. That's a very likely scenario. And for the ICC, it would be an important factor in considering interests of justice, whether pursuing the investigation and trial would be in the interests of justice, meaning would it cause more harm in the Philippines if it continues with the trial or not.
Mm-hmm. Christina, another point here. Former President Rodrigo Duterte has filed a certificate of candidacy for Davao City Mayor. How does that actually complicate or affect the fact-finding probe of the ICC?
I would say that it affects the implementation or execution of a warrant. Local chief executive exercises some degree of control over local police. And within that context, we've seen how the Davao arrest of
Apollo Quiboloy,
was enforced. And so we're looking at different scenarios, similar scenarios as to that. If one of those who are to be arrested is the Davao City Mayor, then it will really pose complications. And hopefully it won't, hopefully one of those scenarios, well, one of those scenarios already is, or several of those scenarios would be violent scenarios. Hopefully, we won't get there to those violent scenarios.
Right. And to be fair, still no guarantee that he would actually win the mayoralty elections in Davao City, considering that another Nograles will be running against him. But let's talk about the frailty that the former president seems to be displaying right now. Would you say that that would also affect a possible arrest against the former chief executive?
For the ICC, age and, well, health condition is only a matter for consideration as regards detention conditions and not whether he or she should be arrested. On another point, he or any arrested person, given health consideration and age considerations, could also apply for what we call bail for release, temporary release, and these would be significant factors. But I think what would be very significant for the ICC is the certainty of this person facing trial, that this person will not flee and will not evade the hands of justice, so-called. So I would, you know, say that it would be safer for Duterte, if he volunteers himself in case there is a warrant of arrest, to go to The Hague. And it would be less taxing on him to go to court if he was detained somewhere close by.
Are you actually even hopeful that that is a plausible scenario given the personality of the former president?
Well, of course, if you have to lay down the scenarios, you lay down everything from the worst to the best. And I guess that would be the best scenario. He comes forward, says that. That's also part of his personality, though, no? For him to accept responsibility that he is willing to accept. So at sometimes we've heard him say, extrajudicial killings, yan lang ang kasalanan ko. Akong bahala sa inyo kapag winapatay kayo. Hopefully, he considers that as well. That for him, accountability is an integral part of our democratic system and of his personality as well.
I have to be very honest, that's a very optimistic point of view. And speaking of optimism, tell me about your thoughts with regard to the PNP deciding to revisit some drug-related cases following the recent revelations from the House Quadcom hearings.
Well, you know, for the victims, all we have is hope. As to the PNP investigations, of course, we very much welcome these investigations, though long overdue. Imagine it's 2024. These killings started 8 years ago. And if it needed this, what was the impetus for these kinds of investigations? It was essentially we're saying that these are all politically motivated. We need the Dutertes and the Marcoses needed to publicly break up, before these investigations could continue. For the PNP, it doesn't do well to indicate sincerity in the investigations, because otherwise, if they were sincere, they would have started this as early as before. Although we understand that the witnesses are just coming forward today, I mean, come on, with their investigative prowess, perhaps they would have made better headway closer to the time of the killings. And this does not bode well, actually. This kind of belated investigation does not bode well for other victims of the war on drugs. There are many of those whose kin were killed in vigilante killings. And in these cases, how would we identify the killers? The CCTV footage would be erased already. The witnesses would maybe have relocated already. So hopefully we get the same kind of treatment for all and for the thousands others of killings.
Right. I can't help but mention that Kian De Los Santos, the unfortunate poster boy for the EJK, or the extrajudicial killings under the Duterte administration, would have turned 27 by now. He was 17 when he was killed. That's how long it took already.
Yes, I know. And for many of the victims, they have children, or they had children. And one of these children now, who was months old by the time his father died, is around 7 years old, I think, in elementary school already, and asking, what really happened? So it's been very heartbreaking for many of these families how to explain what really happened. But for this particular kid, he was able to attend, well, he wasn't able to get into the courtroom, but he was able to attend the conviction hearing of the four Caloocan City policemen who killed his father, Gabriel Luis Bonifacio.
Mm-hmm. And Christina, what are legal counsels of these families actually doing to further push the current administration to hasten the proceedings?
Well, proceedings first before that. Domestic courts and domestic tribunals, because frankly we have no more cases to file before domestic courts because of the lack of evidence, even with this renewed interest in the EJ case. In the Quad Committee, what we can do is just present our stories, try to put to fore particular areas and flag particular areas where the drug war killings were hotspots in the drug war killings. For example, Caloocan, bring that for again, Bulacan, and Cebu. In the ICC, it would take a little bit more of prodding. Actually, we've already submitted a lot of information and many documents to the ICC. And hopefully they can look into the connections already. So for us, actually, it's no longer before the ICC, it's no longer about the individual incidents. This is about the pattern of killings. This is about widespread and systematic killings, which we could all pin down, not only to the ones who, you know, pulled the trigger, but to the ones who ordered them. And that would be Rodrigo Duterte.
Mm-hmm. And Christina, it wouldn't be far-fetched to think that interest would eventually die down with regard to the House Quadcom hearings, considering that we are entering an election cycle once lawmakers there begin their campaigns in their districts or even nationwide for party list representatives. They wouldn't have enough quorum to actually proceed with the House Quadcom investigations. What then would you ask lawmakers to prioritize at this point? And what is the ideal timeline for the Quadcom to eventually wrap up its investigations?
Well, I wouldn't want to put a time frame on the Quadcom hearings. In fact, we've heard the chairman talk about a continuing investigation even until the next Congress. Well, that is on the premise that they were to be re-elected. But at the least, as an exercise in due diligence, the Quadcom hearings, or even hearings before the House Committee on Human Rights, that's where we first started bringing in the victims for their testimonies. That's crucial for us because, as it turns out, I mean, the witnesses aren't coming forward in all at the same time. So we won't expect them even today. Today would have been another session for the QuadCom, but it was actually postponed. So even right now, not many witnesses are coming forward. So we would want to make it as comprehensive as possible. But to be fair for the victims, hopefully they wrap up within or alongside the framework of the ICC. For the victims, we actually are looking at the ICC, an international investigation, to be more circumspect in the investigation because they would be remote, they would be distanced from political developments. They would not be affected, of course, they would not be up for elections by 2025 or 2028. They should not be affected by any political developments, except that, I mean, as to the substance of the investigation. But yeah, for the ICC, we would just like to cooperate further. And in case a trial begins, unlike the QuadCom, this would be a judicial investigation and judicial proceedings. Hopefully that's where Duterte and all the other respondents would get the due process that they have denied our victims in the first place.
And here's to hoping that we will see some fruits of labor from the ICC by year end. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, ICC Assistant to Counsel Attorney Christina Conti.
Thank you, Katrina. Ingat.